Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on Newsradio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Purdy's have served this valley for decades because I've had the ability to find the best insurance, auto, home, life, business, doesn't matter, and find it for the right price, the best price. Doing everything they can to save their customers money. And then, look, you have insurance for a reason. Well, something happens and you need it, they will jump in as if it happened to them, because as far as they're concerned, it did. They're your partner in all this. It's Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. I'm in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. All right. Well, let's get to our play-by-play call of the day. Marcus Mariota. Well, he picked the best guy to throw it to, himself.
Mariota takes the snap, looks to his right, looking, flushed out. Now back to his left, pumping, throwing into the end zone. No, he kept it. Dove for the end zone himself and got in. Oh, my goodness. I thought for sure Mariota had thrown it. What a play. Let's see exactly how it went. It was batted back to him. He did throw it. He caught it for a touchdown. Touchdown, Titans. What a play, Marcus Mariota, who just threw and caught a touchdown pass.
Some people are so selfish with their statistics. I'm sorry, I'm going to do it all. What a play. That was a crazy game. Crazy game. Tennessee won 22-21, rallying from a 21-3 deficit, and now they get to be sacrificed against the Patriots. Okay. All right. Matt Leon, KYW in Philadelphia. The Eagles are in a rare spot. Talk about that in a moment. Matt, welcome. Great to have you with us.
Great to be with you.
Well, this is an unusual spot for a number one seed to be. The unusual spot is they're an underdog at home.
Yeah.
At home.
Yeah, no question about it.
It's all quarterback oriented. And it has nothing to do with, it has nothing to do with Nick Foles as a quarterback. He's a good NFL quarterback. He's not great, but he's not Carson Wentz.
Right.
So
I think it's also based on the last 8-12 quarters the Eagles have played as a team.
No doubt.
Eagles really haven't put together 4 good quarters on both sides of the ball in quite a long time. You know, I mean, the offense played well against the Giants 3 weeks ago, but the defense was terrible, and the defense has been good the last couple weeks, the last couple games, but the offense has been awful. And I know the last game against Dallas, I think for the most part, you just kind of throw out the window. It was a glorified preseason game. But, you know, the Eagles haven't been, you know, what they were early in the season. I mean, obviously the loss of Wentz is a big reason for that. But, you know, I also don't think, you know, having the number one seed playing at home, sitting for 2 weeks, having everybody tell them how overrated they are and how they're going to be one and done, I don't think that's a bad thing. I think you'll have an Eagles team coming out with their hair on fire on Saturday trying to prove the world wrong.
Well, how can they prove the world wrong? What's the formula to do it?
Take care of the football on offense. Don't ask Nick Foles to do too much. I think you'll see a healthy helping of Jay Ajayi. I think you'll also see a little more of LeGarrette Blount than we've seen the last month. And just continue to play defense like they have the last couple weeks. I'm pretty confident defensively they will keep Atlanta at bay. I think Atlanta will get theirs, but I think the defense will make it possible where the offense only has to get in the end zone a couple of times and not make silly mistakes to win this game.
You watched, I'm sure, some of the, if not all, the Falcons-Rams game the other night. What was your thought in watching Atlanta play?
I thought they played well. I mean, Atlanta's been an interesting case this year because you just kind of look at that roster, you look at that stat sheet, and you see Matt Ryan, Julio Jones, Mohamed Sanu, Devontae Freeman, Tevin Coleman, and you're like, wow, this group should average 35 points a game.
Right.
And then you watch them play, and they're not terrible on offense, but something's just not there. Consistency's not there. They very rarely have it, you know, clicking on all cylinders. And as a result, I think they averaged, you know, 12, 13 points less this season than they did last year, despite having much of the same and probably all the same key personnel. Different offensive coordinator, obviously, that plays a big role. But, you know, as far as the game against the Rams, I thought they took advantage of a Rams team that was anxious early, that looked like a team that hadn't played in the playoffs, you know, this group before. I think they also took advantage of the Rams not giving Todd Gurley the ball enough. And on offense, they did some of the things they could do. Chunk plays, got the ball to Julio Jones. They didn't actually run the ball quite as well as I thought they would. But, you know, I think that game was made because their defense played really well. And I think the Rams helped them with some shaky execution and some shaky play calling.
Yeah, and that's something that you look at in a game like this. I don't see a lot of points in this game. I don't know about you, but I don't see a lot of points, and I think the Eagles cannot be in a shootout.
No, I don't think they're built for one right now. Not at the, I mean, you can get in a shootout week 15 with the terrible Giants team, but in the playoffs, I would really be surprised if you know, the game got into a 30s to win it. No, I agree with you. I think you're looking at something like 20-14, something like that. I honestly think that's really the type of game it has to be for the Eagles.
And of all the times for the weather to get warm.
Yeah, but you know what? The Eagles have looked terrible in the cold.
Yeah, they have. But that Dallas game to me is just, I mean, you're right. That was preseason game number 4.
Yeah.
I mean, it really was.
But that Oakland game, they were awful.
Yeah, they were
offensively.
Awful. Yeah, they were.
They were awful.
Yeah, and that game meant something too. That game meant something. Maybe they're a warm, maybe they're a warm weather team playing in Philadelphia.
Yeah, and I think I also think what is common this time of year is we undersell the importance of that first round bye.
Yeah,
and how much it recharges a team. And I think in this case, we're also, and I say we, I mean the overall general feel and stuff people are talking about. You know, if the Falcons team had to go out to California, fly back, now they have to fly to Philadelphia. That's a lot of travel, you know, and all that while the Eagles have been relaxing. Now, it could be one of those things where the Falcons have found some momentum very quietly. They have won 7 of 9, including that playoff game. And, you know, maybe the momentum, and maybe you and I are talking a week from now and we go, wow, the Eagles really look like a team that hadn't played a meaningful game in weeks, and the Falcons came out and hit the ground running.
Right.
Or it's possible we are talking and saying, wow, that Eagles team really looked refreshed, looked ready to go, they looked sharp, and the Falcons really looked tired, didn't they? It's one of those things you don't know until you know.
Do you think that this is the time where we sit back and we look at the acquisition of Jay Ajayi and we say, you know what, with the playoffs in mind and the way the weather is this time of the year, wow, what a wise pickup that was. The Eagles understood how critical the ground game was at this time of the year.
Oh, yeah. I do not think it's crazy that you could see them run the ball 45, 50 times on Saturday.
Right.
Now, a lot of that would be dictated by how the game flow was. But between Ajayi, LeGarrette Blount, to a lesser effect, Corey Clement, it would not surprise me to see them just try to grind one out here. And if they're lucky enough to get a lead into the second quarter, just try to suck the air out of the joint offensively.
Wow, that's interesting. What were your thoughts watching the other playoff games this weekend?
Andy Reid's going to Andy Reid no matter where he is and what the situation is.
Oh, boy.
Andy Reid's a good coach, but, man, blind spot after blind spot after blind spot. Same, you know, how in the world Kareem Hunt can get 5 carries in the final 3 quarters of a playoff game that you lead at 1 point by 3 scores is just amazing to me. And then when you throw in, you don't have Travis Kelce for much of that game.
Yeah.
It's borderline criminal. You know, I thought the Bills-Jacksonville game was pretty much just exactly what I thought it would be.
Yes.
I thought it would be, you know, a street fight. You would struggle to score. It's amazing. I mean, Blake Bortles made some really important plays with his feet.
Yes.
Like he finished with 88 yards. But, God, he was terrible throwing the football.
Oh, my goodness.
Absolutely terrible throwing the football. And I kind of got the feeling of a happy to be there from the Bills. It'd been so long, and they had worked so hard to finally break that streak and get in. I mean, they only lost by a touchdown, and you know had their chances at that one. But I almost feel like their playoff team was getting into the postseason. And the Saints are tough. That Saints Panthers game. I feel like, you know, what did it finish? 5-point game. It's one of those games that it never felt like it was that close. I watching it, I really felt like that the Saints were in control throughout. They did their best to try to give it away at the end, but Saints are going to be a tough out. Saints are going to be a very, very tough out.
Yes, they will be. A very tough out. Interesting, I guess Bortles was in the parking lot after the game, and a little kid asked, you know, they threw him the ball, he caught it, and he threw it back, and he missed him. Yeah, it's just, I mean, you get concerned about that stuff, don't you?
But
I want to ask you about the officiating, though. This is not another red-letter weekend for these guys.
No, it's not good. And I've said for a while, and I don't know if I've said it to you, but I don't think the NFL product's good. And I think if we were to have a parallel universe where there was no fantasy football, I would be fascinated to see the interest levels and the ratings of the NFL, because I think a lot of their success is people watch the games. Yes, they do, but they watch them for their own personal reasons, as far as, you know, financial things on the line and stuff like that. As far as quality of play, and my point is going along with that, is the replays and, you know, what is a catch, and it's absurd. And I think it really sucks the life out of, you know, how long did they in that Rams game try to determine if that was a catch.
And you knew right away what the deal was. I mean, you knew right away.
I've said for a long time that I think one of the big problems that all sports, but specifically the NFL, has made with replay is they've tried to use it to get everything 100% right, which is absolutely impossible no matter the situation.
That's
so
right.
When you're trying to achieve an impossible goal, you see yourself twisting yourself in knots like what we're seeing right now. I've always thought the goal of replay should be to avoid egregious errors.
Yes.
Avoid the ball that obviously one-hopped the receiver. Avoid the guy who obviously had stepped out of bounds before he caught the ball. Stuff like that. And I say with replay, they get 30 seconds to look at it. If you can't tell in 30 seconds,
that's
if it is not something that jumps out at you in 30 seconds, then you know what? The official did the best he could and got it as good, as right as he could on the field. Let's keep going. And I think that's the problem. And by trying to get something perfect, you get what we get now with a catch, where you can just feel announcers starting to cringe every time there's a replay and you start to see the ball move, because nobody knows what anything is anymore.
Right. And there was the Rams-Falcons game where, in looking at the replay, you could tell right away what the ball went off the foot, I think, if I remember the play I'm talking about. Right? And they're like, okay, well, that's it. Right. And then Ed Hockley, after about a minute, says, oh, we're going to review. And everybody's looking around each other. Review what?
Yeah.
We've already seen it. Everybody at home has already seen it. We know that it's a catch. It didn't hit the ground. We know that. We saw that. And then you could, you know, and then of course, then Al Michaels, to his credit, Michaels is brutally honest. He had, no kidding.
Yeah. No, it's become a running joke. It's become a punchline. And it every week you feel like a little bit more credibility is ripped away from the league because of this. And I think it's just got to – the whole replay system has to be rethought. Not gotten rid of, but rethought. And if I was in charge, that's how I would do it. I would look at it and change the whole idea. We're not trying to get everything right. That's impossible. We just want to make sure we don't screw up big time and games are won or lost because of something that is obviously wrong.
Well, now that we have that solved, let's talk about the border wall. All right, no, I'm just going. Matt, thanks so much. Appreciate your time.
My pleasure. Talk to you next time.
Matt Leon, KYW in Philadelphia. We're just solving problems here. It's what we do. Speaking of the problem solvers, Purdy Insurance. They're our sponsor today, along with Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
There are a lot of places to get insurance coverage, but only one place in the Susquehanna Valley ready to put four generations of experience to work for you. Hi, I'm Adam Purdy. At Purdy Insurance, we take the time to talk with you and find the right coverage for your needs. Everyone's situation is unique, so our approach is to customize coverage to best protect you. Whether it's home, auto, or business insurance solutions you need, call, email, or stop in to see how our commitment to personal service can help protect what matters to you.
Kansas? About that. All right, great to have you with us on the show today. Tonight, the national championship game. It's interesting, we haven't talked once really about the national championship game. I've talked a little bit about Jalen Hurts. His ability to run the ball becomes really important in a game like this. Because one area where there's been a level of consistency that you can link all the national championships to for Alabama under Nick Saban would be Saban's ability to consistently recruit not just good, but great college defensive lines. They've had the ability to put more pressure on people than other teams, plus take away their running game. Georgia does a lot of the same thing, to their credit. Their linebackers are really good. And remember, I mean, this is a lot. Some of these guys, Georgia, are guys that played against Penn State in the Tax Slayer Bowl 2 years ago. You know, Roquan Smith and Lorenzo Carter and Dominic Sanders and Terry Godwin and, Sony Michel. These guys all played against Penn State. So we saw them as Smith was a freshman. The others were sophomores. And Nick Chubb was hurt, couldn't play in the game. But it's not like we haven't seen these guys before, because we have. They've grown up, and you see what experience means to them. The defensive front for Georgia is very good. Their linebackers are really good. So they get it. The impact of Kirby Smart is hard to tell. To be honest with you, I think he's obviously shown he's a really good coach, because you can take very good talent and you can mess it up. Kirby Smart has taken very good talent and he's done a really good job of accentuating it. So that's where you deserve a lot of credit. But he didn't recruit most of these guys. Sanders, Smith, Carter, Michelle, Chubb, Godwin. He didn't recruit any of those guys. So the impact that he has, and you see the Georgia recruiting class this year is considered to be a top five recruiting class, and some say it's one or two. Well, that's where you're starting to see that, you know, his ability to go in to places and sell what his vision is of Georgia is very effective. But we'll see how it plays out over the years. Nick Saban has done a great job of obviously recruiting great talent. You don't get a guy like Minka Fitzpatrick or a Calvin Ridley or the running backs they've had unless you've recruited top shelf the entire time. That's why you look, for example, at the fine young running back for the New Orleans Saints, Alvin Kamara. Well, Alvin Kamara, it'll show, is listed as being from Tennessee, right? Alvin Kamara started his college career at Alabama. And the backfield that he was a part of at Alabama included Derrick Henry, T.J. Yeldon, Kenyon Drake, and Alvin Kamara. Those are the four running backs that came in at that time at Alabama. Well, they're all in the NFL now. Kamara did not play his first year. He had a couple of problems off the field. He got suspended by Nick Saban. He went to a junior college, and then he resurrected himself and went to Tennessee for 2 years, and now he's in the NFL. I think he was a third-round pick for the Saints. And Kamara had a really nice year for the Saints in conjunction with Mark Ingram. But that just tells you about the depth that they've had, that happened to be the four running backs, primary running backs they had in the program at that time when Kamara was there for his one season. But overall, Saban has done a great job of consistently recruiting outstanding talent on the defensive line, And Alabama's been able to own that area of real estate and then put pressure on quarterbacks with four guys. They have not had to blitz. A guy like Roquan Smith's going to end up being a very good NFL linebacker. He's going to be in the same mode as Reuben Foster. Move him to the outside, because Smith will not be an inside linebacker in the NFL. Move him to the outside where he's got the pursuit, the angles, and so forth. Just like when Foster finally got his chance to play for the 49ers, which, by the way, coincided with Jimmy Garoppolo playing quarterback. You never really talked much about what Reuben Foster's return meant to the 49ers because of the Garoppolo factor. But that's going to be tonight. We haven't talked much about it, but the part about Jalen Hurts is, I don't care what his throwing percentage is. Right? Watch him play. He does not lead guys into yards after the catch. He turns what can be an explosive Alabama passing game into a very station-to-station passing game because he is a thrower. He is not a quarterback. He doesn't look off guys. I mean, in fact, 28th start, he is no better at throwing the football in his 28th start than he was in his first.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And we are in the Sunbury Motors Studio on a day brought to you by our good friends at Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to PurdyInsurance.com. Purdy's have served this valley for decades because they've been able to go out and put together the best insurance coverage. I don't care if it's auto, home, life, business, whatever, but they always find you the best coverage that fits you to a T. They also go out and they make sure it's at the best price that fits your budget because the customer comes first. And if anything happens, that's why you have insurance. That's why having a great relationship with your insurance agent is important. You want to go with people who are great with people. That's Purdy. The Purdy company is unbelievable. Great people there. They'll go to bat for you right away with everything they have because the customer comes first. You want to make sure you're protected. So, Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to PurdyInsurance.com. All right, so we get everybody up to date there, and 800-795-9565, 800-795-9565 is our number. You can jump in. We'd like to hear from you. I know we had told Dick and Milton to call back at this time, and he's done just that. Hi, Dick, how are you today?
Hey, Steve, how are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for asking.
Hey, I was listening to your interview with the reporter out of the West Coast in the 3:30 hour,
yeah.
Half hour.
Yeah.
And he talked about Gruden and one and on, and he mentioned the name quite two or three times, and I thought maybe you could get him one for an interview is Rich Gannon. You know, he actually, you know, he's a Delaware guy, so he comes over and sees Joe Susan, but he also, his oldest daughter graduated from Bucknell last year, and his youngest daughter is at Bucknell now. So he comes around quite often.
Yeah, no, that's a great idea. The other guy, I'll talk to is John Kondo from Phillipsburg Osceola High School.
Yeah,
25 miles from here. John's the long snapper for the Raiders and has been for years.
Yeah, but I just, you know, I've talked to Coach to Rich Gannon several times when he's been in here, and I, you know, I guess I didn't really connect him too much with Gruden, but he did.
No, that's exactly right. That's why that Super Bowl that Tampa Bay won was so interesting, because he had Brad Johnson on his side, but he had just finished coaching Rich Gannon on the other right before that.
Yeah, as I say, Joe Susan and him are both Delaware football players, and Coach Susan, obviously. But he does come around, and he'll be around. He'll be around this spring more, because it'll be tennis season again. He might be stopping by when they start their tennis
season.
Very
good.
Might just be somebody to get on the air for a little while and pick him up, pick his brain a little bit about Coach Gruden.
Great idea. Plus, Rich does a great job on CBS.
Yeah.
Very, very
yeah.
good job as an analyst.
There you go. Just a thought.
Yeah, great thought. I appreciate it.
It is. Appreciate it, Dick.
Thank you.
Well, Sean, you're replaceable. Oh, that's really cruel, man.
My head's on the swivel, just like Derek Carr's.
how about that, the Derek Carr thing? That was like, whoa, Derek Carr. Wow.
Well, Gruden works his quarterbacks. We know that for a fact. So, yeah, Dieter brought up a great point, and he should. But, yeah, Dieter brought up a great point last hour as to quarterbacks and his track record of coaching them. So.
Well, I mean, some people wear them out. A great quarterback coach was, obviously, Steve Spurrier. But he was also harder on them than he was on other people. Yeah, so, it all depends. Personalities are different. And because personalities are different, they want that guy to be an extension of them. Okay. Well, if they want that person to be an extension of them, then that's how you end up with a guy being harder on the quarterback, because they want that to be an extension of them. Now, you talked in the beginning of Kerry Collins. Well, Kerry Collins, now a college Hall of Famer, and congrats to him. What a career he carved out. And I think, it ended up, I believe he is the last Big Ten quarterback to be drafted in the first round. How about that? He's the last Big Ten quarterback, I believe, to be drafted in the first round. Now, that's amazing. 17 years in the NFL. Carolina, the Giants, the Titans primarily. But that's amazing. And, to me, that's amazing. And congratulations to him. What a great college career. What, 92 he did okay. 93, Kerry was really good. 94, he was off the charts.
Yeah, Antoine Randle L. Close, second round draft pick by the Steelers.
Yeah, but he wasn't drafted as a quarterback, though.
That is correct.
He was drafted as an athlete. I mean, he didn't play quarterback in the NFL. And you're right, Randle L. was a second round pick, but even then he was not drafted as a quarterback. Amazing. And what a career he put together, huh? What a great career. So congratulations to him, another Hall of Famer for Penn State. That was announced earlier today. National championship game is tonight. All right, so who do you have?
Oh, I haven't wavered from our pick segment on Friday. I'm sticking with Alabama. It's, you know, the fool me once, you know, fool me twice. It's like, how can you go against Alabama? I know if Oklahoma was playing Alabama tonight, I'd take Oklahoma.
See, I think that Baker Mayfield would have given them a puncher's chance, but I think that's just a case. When you look at what they did this year, okay, in that championship game, you look at that. And the part that stuns you is that, and again, this is where the rookie comes in to play when it comes to, you know, where experience comes into play for a team. And that's the inexperience of Lincoln Riley. Not being there before in any capacity. And then suddenly, you know, they finally got to that point, and he kind of, I don't know. You know, you can just tell that, you know, he got conservative. He coached as if he had something to lose, and they ended up losing because of it instead of just going for it. At least that's how I looked at it. And that's why I think they're not in it.
I think we're going to get let down tonight for some reason, just because of last year's game being so phenomenal. And then you had the Rose Bowl almost a week and a half ago being phenomenal as well.
Right.
But hopefully we'll have a great matchup. But it may be too much to ask for.
Yeah, could be. could be too much to ask for.
But at least we have the first ever college football national championship halftime show featuring right. Kendrick Lamar. So I know you'll be riveted. You'll be riveted okay. to your TV set
okay.
for that one.
But I do want to say this. Okay? Guess what was ratings-wise? We're talking about the NFL was down, what, 9.7% this year? Okay, 9.7% down, right? Guess what was up? Bowl games up 12%. ESPN had 35 of them. They were up 12% to an average of 4,955,000 viewers per game.
Well, their execs are dancing to that.
And it wasn't just when it came to being on New Year's Day, it was great, you know, and having that. Okay, that's great. Except it turned out that every platform of a bowl game was up. Every platform of bowl games happened to be up. That's amazing. Every platform. That's the amazing part. Up 12%. This goes back to what I talked about. You may think from the outside looking in that there are too many bowl games. Okay, because there are, what, 40 of them. Right, so I got that. But you may think that there are too many Star Wars movies. You may think there are too many Hallmark Christmas movies. You may think that there are that Cheers went two seasons too long. I don't know. But there are people out there that watch it. And
did you and I talk about Hallmark Channel Christmas movies during a commercial break over Christmas time? Because that's a heavily watched channel in my house.
I'm saying, though, but there are people out there who will say there are too many of them. But nobody's telling you to watch.
My pet peeve with them is they start running Christmas movies 4 days before Halloween. I think that's a little too much. But, hey, they're Hallmark. It's part of their brand. It's in their wheelhouse. So what are you going to do? You flip the channel right. and pop something else on you like to see.
Right, exactly. But again, this goes to just because you may think there's too much of something doesn't necessarily mean that there is, quote, too much of something if somebody is watching it. Well, it turned out that, you know, you could sit, people could sit there and go, oh,
well, I'm definitely a proud contributor to ESPN's ratings because I will freely admit, and granted, I had some free time leading up to Christmas, but that's the most bowl games I watched in years, at least 5 years for me.
Right.
Quite a few.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's what you have. You have people, oh, it's too much of this, too much of that. Well, it doesn't matter if you think it's too much. You know, it's up to the audience to eventually determine if there's been too much of anything. It's up to the audience to determine that. And there are people that free time, and because they have some free time, they sit there and they go, okay, you know what? I'm going to watch that. Okay. Well, they end up watching it, and it counts. It's every platform was up. So this was not a question of whether it was just the major bowl games that threw them over the top. No, that's not what happened here. What happened here was you had a lot of people just with some time, and they watched. That's what it is. Pretty simple. Pretty simple. And they're up 12%. Take a break. We'll wrap things up in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Okay, great to have you with us on the show as we wrap things up on to Bloomington, Indiana for tomorrow's show. Ray Fittipaldo is going to join us from the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. Ray, for a long time, covered Penn State football and is now covering the Steelers, who are, let's face it, I think everybody knows they're probably going to get shut out by Jacksonville, but still, they'll give it a shot at
home.
What?
Hey, oh, huh?
What? I thought I'd slip that past you. The funny thing is about the first Jacksonville game, think about this. The first Jacksonville game is no different than the game they played yesterday. I mean, Jacksonville did not have a great offense against the Steelers that day. They ran two interceptions back for a touchdown. They picked off five passes. What's the difference between that and the game that the Jags played yesterday? Yeah, Steelers avoid the big mistake. They'll beat that team by, I'd say, 14 to 17 points. And they go to Foxborough, and let's see when they go to Foxborough if they can somehow get themselves out of the field position.
I would think this coming Sunday compared to the first Jacksonville game in October, Juju Smith-Schuster had not blossomed yet. Martavis Bryant was not up to 100% game mode. Vance McDonald didn't play. So you got three crucial factors there. And I think you'll agree with me on this. If AB does not practice on Wednesday, I would not think he'll play on Sunday. What do you think?
I don't think he's going to play.
Did practice. He was at the practice facility today. I'm holding out hope. Since I'm going to be there on Sunday, I'm holding out hope.
Are you going, huh?
Yes.
I got the day off. So.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. But I've got nothing this weekend. I've got a game tomorrow night at Indiana and the home game with Nebraska on Friday night. Then the next home game is Monday, right after that, a week from tonight with Minnesota.
Two weekends off in a row.
I know.
Well played.
Don't quite know what to do. So this is how...
You may end up in the attic.
Right. This is how a section of America lives, huh? What do you mean you have the whole weekend off? Yes, I do. Yeah, I have to admit, I came back from the Northwestern game on Friday night. I took care of the update shows like I was supposed to. There's another piece I had to do for somebody else. I took care of it, and I looked around like, okay, we're done. So, and for everyone who sent birthday wishes on Facebook or on Twitter, I guess Twitter gave me up pretty good, led by the crafty James Franklin.
Yes.
Yes, the crafty James Franklin makes sure the word got out there, like everybody, about birthday time. You know, and then Pat Chambers and Sandy Barber and P.J. Mullen and a group of other people. So
Bob Buhner wishing you a happy 40th.
Well, that's Buhner sending out that wish in 1998. Just got here. But I appreciate all the birthday wishes. I know there were a lot of them up and down the valley, and appreciate that. And of course, Sean's was last week, too. And Sean's a bigger part of the show than I am, so you know, I want to make sure everybody knows that the awesome job that he does. Now, unlike certain other members of the company, we work on our birthdays. I remember the first time. It's a true story. This is true. So this is all kidding aside. Like I said, I mean, we kid about the suit a lot, and it's all kidding.
It is.
Well, to a point. There's some parts are actually very accurate that we kid about.
Oh, I tell people, hey, my birthday's January the 4th. It was July 4th. Yeah, I have the day off, sure.
Yeah, 4th of July, yeah, because the show's always off.
Yeah.
I mean, if your birthday was December 25th, you'd be off. But the first year, well, I'm taking whatever day it is off. I don't know when his birthday is. Is it in August?
I'm drawing a blank. I probably shouldn't draw a blank, but
I know. We all should know.
We should not.
All right. I'm sure we'll get a text here in a moment. And he says to me, I'm taking that day off. I said, okay, fine. Have a good time. Well, it's my birthday. I'm taking my birthday off. And I didn't say anything in the other end. I was stunned. I was like, what?
Well, if it's August, we know how he feels about August.
I don't know. It could be May, June, whatever. It's in the summer sometime, isn't it?
I should know, but I don't know.
Well, it's just all. But then,
have to turn in my friend card.
I mean, this guy isn't kidding. He actually takes days off for his birthday.
He did.
Okay. To each his own. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Your station for news, weather, business, and CBS Sports Radio. News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. And on WKOK.com.